So for your quiz. You can factor, but you cannot cancel. So that means you're not going to have any holes, right? Okay. But we do have a denominator. So whatever else goes on, x cannot be 2. Your vertical asymptote is at 2. Vertical asymptotes happen where the denominator is 0. Now, if I let y be 0 and solve that equation, I'm going to have x intercepts at 3 and negative 1. Remember, you're letting y be 0 and you're solving this equation. So you multiply this over here, it's still 0, so x is 3 or negative 1. If we put a 0 in for x, we get 3 halves. So our y-intercept is 3 halves. And behavior asymptote. The power on top is bigger than the power on the bottom. So what does that mean I have to do? Divide. What if the powers are the same? Then we have a horizontal asymptote at whatever the coefficients are. But I have to divide because my power on top is bigger. No remainder, don't care about the remainder. This is my end behavior asymptote, y equals x plus 0 or y equals x, which is this line right here. Now, based on that information, I have to draw in my picture. If I'm not sure, I can always plot more points. And some of you did. But I think there's enough to see that's what's happening. And this is what's happening. But again, if you can't see that, and you're not comfortable with that, just plot a few more points. Some of you connected these three dots. Why can those absolutely not be connected? There's a vertical asymptote running down through the middle of it. You never, ever cross a vertical asymptote, ever. Okay, all right, so now we have to answer the questions. What's the limit as x approaches infinity? Well, x approaches infinity that way. So as I draw my curve to the right, what is it? What's my pencil doing? Going up. Going up. Without bound. It just keeps going. Now what happens as I approach 0? Well, here's where x is 0. What happens where x is 0? Y is 3 halves. So that's 3 halves. Remember, if it's a point, it's just the y-coordinate. That's all you need. All right, now this says approach 2. 2 is an asymptote. So I'm going to approach 2 from the negative side. As I approach 2 from the negative side, what's happening? My pencil. Positive infinity. I don't know how we missed that, guys. You somehow need to get that sorted out in your head, because this says we're coming from the left toward 2, and my pencil is going up. I don't know how you get down from that. Somebody put negative infinity. I don't get it. Does anybody want to ask a question or something you're not clear about? As you're coming toward this line right here where x is 2, your pencil is going up. Now what happens as you head off the page to the left? We're going to negative infinity, so we're going this way. As we head to the left, what's our pencil doing? Negative infinity. As we approach two from the positive side, what's our pencil doing? As we approach two from the positive side, the curve is going down. It's going down. And what about as we approach three? Well, isn't, oh, there's three. So what happens to y as I get closer, as x goes to three? As x goes to three, y goes to? Does it matter which side I come in from? No, it's a point. It's going to be the same thing.
When x is going to two, like from the positive side, I thought you would go up. Why don't you just like?
Here's where x is two. As you get closer and closer and closer to two from the positive side, which direction is your pencil going?
Down.
All right, get your packet out. The very first page. Have we done that? Well, I don't know if it's the first page or the last page. It says practice quiz at the top. Have we done that yet?
No.
All right, let's do this. And then we'll get your homework out. We'll get your homework questions. And then we'll do it.
The one, the very first page it freak out was.
This is practice quiz. The only one that says practice quiz. Well, it's a front or back of the packet that says practice quiz on it. All right, so what do we want to do? This is a monster problem. What do we want to do first?
Get back to the bottom.
Well, we'll factor the whole shebang.
True.
So, I don't know. I can take a 2 out of the top, but I'm not sure I can group it. So, what am I going to have to do with the top?
Division?
Yeah. Yep. Let's see. Can I see a number that'll work right off the bat? Two will work. So let's divide 2 out. Yeah, 2 works. And what's left is x squared plus 4x plus 3, which also factors. So my top is this, and my bottom is this. Okay. So we're going to have one hole, right?
Mm-hmm.
And where will that hole be? I'm going to erase this work now so I have room to draw this. Where will that hole be? Where x equals 2. And if x equals 2, what will y equal? 2 times 5 times 3 over 4?
So like 7.5?
Yep, that's 7. Yeah, 15.5, 7.5. So I have a hole at 2 comma. Bless you. 7.5. One hole. This is what I'm graphing now. Any vertical asymptotes?
Yeah.
Where? Where's my vertical asymptote?
-2.
Do I have any zeros? Two of them.
-3, 0, and -1.
-3 and -1. Yep. Do I have have a y-intercept. Let's let x be 0. What do I get for my y-intercept? 3? You go back to the original if you want. If you put in zeros for all the x's, all you have left is 12 over 4. Now, even in my reduced problem, which I'm going to multiply it back out. Hey, there's no horizontal asymptote. Why is there no horizontal asymptote?
Because
the power on top is bigger. So I went ahead and multiplied all that back out. Normally I would never want to do that, but what am I going to have to do here?
I'm
going to have to divide. So I had to multiply it all back out, unfactor it, so that I can do my division and get my end behavior asymptote. Under what circumstances is the end behavior asymptote horizontal?
The exponents.
When the exponents match. These don't. Right? So what do I come up with here? What is my end behavior asymptote? Y equals 2x plus 4. So I have slope of 2. So there's my line, y equals, oh shoot, I gotta go up to 3.
Into what?
I drafted wrong. Now, based on that, that's everything. That point's got me a little bit bothered. Yeah, that point I didn't draft my line very well.
Oh, that's what you're doing, sorry.
That's on top of that, yeah. That would be the point 2,8, and that's above 2,7.5. So based on that, can I see what this looks like? I think so. A lot like the one on your quiz. And there's only one limit question. It says, what's the limit as x approaches negative 2 from the negative side? Now just take a moment, let's see if we can all get this right. We're approaching negative 2 from the negative side. Here's negative 2 right here. That vertical asymptote. You're approaching it from the negative side. Going up or down? Up. Yep, right here, going up. So that would be positive infinity. Remember, when you approach a vertical asymptote, you either have to go up or down. Just look at your picture and see which one it is. All right, let's do number 2 real quick. That picture is drawn. What's the limit as x approaches infinity? All right, let's see if we can get this right. We're approaching infinity. Where is that? Off the right side of the page. What's happening to your y values as you draw off the right side? You just keep going off the right side. What's happening to your y values? What are they getting closer to? Negative 1. Are they approaching negative 1 from the top or the bottom? From the top. So you would say that. That's the answer to the first question.
I don't get it.
approaching infinity, you're going off the page this way. What's happening to your Y values? They're dropping down closer and closer to negative one. Now, what about going the other way? Going toward negative infinity.
So they would be dropping to positive?
They'd be dropping to negative.
Look at the picture. What are they doing as they go this way? What are they getting closer to? Negative one from the top. They're doing exactly the same thing on the right or the left side.
So the same answer?
Yeah. Now what about as they approach negative three? Now wait a minute. What's x equals negative three? That's an asymptote, a vertical asymptote. So as the curve approaches that asymptote, it's either going to go up or go down. What's it doing on the left side of that asymptote? Is it going up or down on the left side?
It's going up.
Going up. So C is positive infinity. Now 2 is also an asymptote, right? What are we doing as we approach 2 from the right side, from the positive side? What's happening to our pencil? Positive infinity. Going up. All right, let's get your homework down. Take a look at that. Who found something in the homework that you just weren't sure about? This is your review sheet. Part of it was calc, part of it was not. Jamie. Well, it is an or equal to problem. Well, the 2 can be, because it's in the denominator. And you cannot have x be 2, because that would make your denominator be 0. Remember, we talked about that. In an or equal to problem, the dots should be shaded in, but you can't ever have a denominator dot shaded in, because the denominator can never equal 0. That makes sense? Okay. Who else found something on this review sheet? Oh my gosh, there were lots of problems here, folks. Willie?
Number 7.
Okay, this is a mixture problem. What's our formula, Lily, for a mixture problem? Yep. So what am I doing? We want to end up with 20 pounds. That's 360. That's what I want to end up with. And we're going to mix some 250 and some $4. And how many pounds of each kind? Well, I have to call something X. And if they add up to 20, what will the other one be? 20 minus x. There's your equation. Can you solve that, Lily? That's it. That's all there is to it. The percentages are money values this time, but it's the same idea. Bailey? Soccer socks are 575 a pair. It costs them 416 to produce each pair. It's equivalent cost is this. Find how many pairs of socks to pay the legal tuition of $10,800. Okay, wait. Okay, so he needs to end up, basically you want a profit of $10,800. And how do we find profit? Just in general, how do you find profit? Income minus expenses, right? So what's his income? How much is coming in? His only income is 575 times X. If we let X be the number of pairs of socks. Now, what are his expenses?
16.
Well, he has to pay 416 per pair. What else does he have to pay? $3,850 a week. What's overhead? You guys, come on, you're seniors in high school. What's overhead? The lights, the rent, the water, those are your every week bills that you pay. So he has all those expenses, plus he has the materials for the socks, costing $416. So this is what he's bringing in. This is what he's sending out, and we need the difference to be 1080 or 10,800. Okay, can you solve that equation?
Yeah.
All right, who else has a question about something? Oh my gosh, you guys, there's tons of questions here. I hope you put some time and energy into this. Bailey? Okay, we keep talking about this. We need to get this. Okay, she's asking, why is the domain in this problem? X has to be between 0 and 5.5. Why is that the domain? Jamie? I'm going to do this one more time, and I wish you would just try to understand this. This paper is 11 inches right here, okay? I'm going to tear a corner out of this side, and I'm going to tear a corner out of this side. Could these be 1-inch corners? Yep, because I got 11 inches, right? So I can take one off each side. Can I take two off each side? Can I take six off each side? No. What's the most I can take off each side if I have 11 inches to work with? 5.5. 11.5. And all you're using that for in this problem is to set up the picture. You're going to set up a picture. And in that problem, we want the volume to be no more than 100. So when you draw a picture of your volume on that interval, it will look something like this. And here is 100. This time, we want the volume to be no more than 100. So we could find these two places, right? But where would we look to get our answer then if we want no more than 100? Where would that be? That would be this part or this part, right? And this is 0 and this is 5.5. So we need to find that number and that number, and then our answer would be between those two and between these two, whatever those points of intersection are. No more than 100. Yesterday it was more than 100, or more than something. All right, so that makes sense to everybody?
Mm-hmm.
So when I do that on my calculator, I'm going to put in two equations. I'm going to put in 100, and I'm going to put in my volume equation. And what's my volume equation going to be? 11 minus 2x. 15 minus 2x and x. And I'm going to graph both of those and find these points using my intercept button. Robert?
Can you please do number 9?
9. Okay, the equation is there. This is just a plug-in problem.
Just plug it in.
Yeah, okay. So what would 2011 be?
Good.
If 0 is 1990 and 1 is 1991, then 2011 would be what?
X. It'd be Y.
No. X, it's an X value, but X would be what? What number would I put in for 2011? I put in zero for 1990. I put in one for 1991. I put in two for 1992. I put in three for 1993. What would I put in for 2011?
Whatever, how many you count up until.
Okay, so just tell me what that would be.
21.
So I'm just going to put in 21 for X, and I'm going to get my answer.
Okay.
And I don't do anything. I plug in 21 for the X value, and that will give it to me. Found something. All right, let's look at practice test two. Or not practice, review sheet two. This will be tonight's homework. It's called review sheet two. Problem 5D.
Is that the one with the math department?
Yep. Don't forget, you all got an email about the canned food drive. Pay attention to that. You will want the bonus points on your exam. Borders of 1.4 on the left, 2 on the top, 1.75 on the bottom, and on the right. And I want to minimize the area. Okay, we did one like this yesterday or the day before or something. Who's got a plan? I want to minimize the area. So we need an equation for the area. Then we'll type it in on our calculator and find the minimum. Nobody can remember. Call one side of the printed, this part right here, we call one side of it X, so I'll call that X. Then what would the other side of the printed have to be if they times together to give 144? 144 divided by X. So those are the dimensions of the inside here. But I need the dimensions of the whole paper. So what are the dimensions of the whole paper going to be?
X plus.
Okay, that's X. I need to add on 1.75 and
2.
So that's 3.75, X plus 3.75.
Yeah.
And then here, I've got 144 over X here in the middle, but I have to add on a 1.75 and a 1.4, which is 3.15.
How do you know what size to have again?
Dan, you're going across the, I want this dimension. So it's that, and that, and that. What's that? 1.4. That's 144 over X. That's 1.75. So your area will simply be those two things times each other. So then we can go to our calculator. And what do I have to see to answer the question? Think about what you're trying to do. What are you trying to do? Minimize it, so what do you have to see? A low point. And I do, magically, I didn't even mess with my window. My window is set, I guess, like it was yesterday. I've got 0 to 100 and 0 to 1500. And that magically, whoops. So again, I've got 0 to 100 on the X's and 0 to 1500 on the Y's. Lots of windows would work, but that one does. I see a minimum. Does it make sense that X min would be 0? Say, why, of course it does, Mrs. Ford, because X stands for the dimensions that printed and it has to be positive. So I came up with 3.09, 238.3. What was the question? What is the minimum area?
238.3.
So this would be the area. This is X. This is this right here. So this is 13. But this is the area. Is that okay with everybody? Okay, that's the last problem on the sheet. Let's do the first problem. And sometimes kids mess this up. What would be your thought on how to proceed with this problem? We always get 0, kids. Isn't that kind of a common theme we have?
Yeah,
we like to get 0.
You took out an X.
And then we factor.
That's all you can do.
And then we go to our number line. And we put a couple of dots on the number line. And where would those dots be?
0 and 8.
And then we just pick a number somewhere. That's not 0 or 8?
1.
If we put 1 in, 1 would give me positive times negative. Is that what I wanted?
No.
No. So this and this must be the answers. What if this had been an or equal to in the problem? What's the only thing that would change? The dots would be colored in. Otherwise, everything is exactly the same.
Will there ever be a time when nothing is shaded?
Yes. We had a problem the other day we talked about. If you had something like x minus 8 squared less than 0, that would be nothing shaded. Because that's impossible. You can't square it and be less than 0. Remember, when there's a square, though, you got to check each section. It isn't going to alternate. Grace?
The problem says only greater than, not equal to, so both of those
would
be open circle.
Yes, I had that originally, and then I said, what if?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So that's the first and the last. Let's do 1E, that's a calculator problem. You want to do this on your calculator? You got a couple of different options. I don't know what you're most comfortable with. What do you want to do? Okay. One strategy, certainly if we were doing it by hand, this is what we would do. But you're not going to have to do that by hand. show up. Be careful. You're tempted to multiply everything by x, but can we do that?
Yeah.
No, because it's an inequality, and we don't know if x is positive or negative. Remember, you do not multiply by variables if it's an inequality. So what do you want to do?
Just plug that in.
If we graph this right here, if we graph that, what would we be looking for? I don't know what it's going to look like. But what would we be looking for?
Numbers greater than zero.
The part of it that's above the x-axis, right? Where this comes out positive, which is above the x-axis. So, you've got a very strange window, if you're like me. So I'm going back to a standard window. Did you get something that looks like this?
Yeah.
All right, now what part of that are we interested in? We're interested in this part right here and this part right here. Because that's the part that's greater than zero, that's positive. So this is easy. This is just all the x's bigger than zero. What am I going to have to do here? Find that point, and how will I do that? Second count, zero. Looks like that point is negative 2.33. So, what do I do then to get my answer? It will be all the x's less than or equal to negative 2.33. Robert?
What window did you have your set to?
Negative 10 to 10, just a standard window.
Okay, because I have like negative 50, because it was like the window I had originally, and it has like a parabola. No, but like just one parabola.
Well, you got an issue there because you should be able to tell from the problem that x can't be zero. So something weird is happening in there, so you need to open that window up because those can't be connected. I see what you're seeing, I get it, but your window is so big that it's connecting these because everything's all squished up right here because you made your window so wide.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly in your picture, there's nothing going on the ends, so you don't need all that space. I changed it and made it even a little bit bigger or smaller, I mean, and you very clearly see there's an asymptote at zero. There has to be. So you just have to pay attention when you're graphing it to what you know is true. And that is, there's an asymptote at zero. So whatever I'm seeing that's connected can't be connected.
Okay.
And adjust accordingly. Okay, now for tomorrow, I have a meeting and will not be here. So here is what everybody needs to bring your iPad tomorrow and your ear things so that you can watch me and work with me working through practice test 2, which is your homework. And there's another sheet in here called, study session. There's a sheet in here called review study session, and I'm going to work on getting that too. So those things, that's going to be in class tomorrow. Right along with me, with your little iPad going and your headphones on.
Study session.